There is a podcast brewing that's about to take over podcasting for good. The only podcast that you are going to need to tune into day in, day out, is the Member Guest Podcast.
If I can hit it down the middle of the fairway, that's great. But again, with the driver right now, the driver sucks.
John Daly, and you're listening to the Member Guest Podcast. Rip it, rip it.
All right. Welcome to the Member Guest Podcast. This is Andy here. Tonight we have a very special guest, golf strategy expert, Mr. Scott Fawcett. Scott, thanks for joining us here on the Member Guest.
Absolutely. I'm excited to see what we talk about. I always like working with club golfers more than tour players. It's get better versus get mad they're not winning every tournament they play in. So I like this topic.
So let's start with your background. I've consumed most of the pieces of content on the internet that you have been on. But for our audience that might not know you, it would be really helpful to get your background and kind of how you got doing what you're doing.
Yeah, you know, I'm just, I was a guy that was, I think, pretty good in college, but honestly, I never really specialized in golf for the most part until I got to college. And so I really just, it's funny, I just really didn't have that much experience, but I played decent at Texas A&M. And then I played professionally for about 5 years after getting out of school and did okay. I mean, I won on the Hooters Tour a couple times and other, mini tour professional golf tournaments, but not just, like an 18-hole shootout. So I was decent, but certainly never made it. And then I started an electricity company kind of on accident in 2002 when Texas deregulated. And honestly, that's like where my journey and all this began. I mean, even though I studied finance and economics, statistics, whatever in college, I didn't really ever think of golf as like a mathematical game like we know poker and chess are. And so once I quit playing professionally, I started playing a lot of poker. And I just really started, like, I was the biggest hothead on earth. My expectations were probably absolutely absurd. When I was playing in my 20s, and just honestly, just playing a lot of poker where like bad beats are going to happen, and you can either get like, it's very obvious. I can either get pissed off and continue spewing money, or I can just keep playing my game and not let a mistake bother you or bad luck or whatever. And I really honestly, I started playing golf a lot better, like after stopping playing professional golf and getting a little bit better mindset. Chris Como and I met in an underground playing poker in an underground poker room back in like 2004. And I started working my golf game with him, a year or two after we'd known each other. Got to where I was playing pretty good. And then in 2008, I decided to enter Q school as a 35-year-old amateur, which I did and got through all four stages and wound up with a crappy Corn Ferry card. And I don't say crappy, I mean, like my status was, I was like, the 20th alternate or something like that. So it was never any good. But I kind of floundered around, shockingly, trying to play part-time professional golf is about as hard as you expect it to be. So that went about as well as you would expect it to. But then that was really when I started, like the strokes gained statistics were coming out in 2000, 10 and 11. And I just really started realizing like, man, just learning that an 8-foot putt on the PGA Tour is 50-50 was like mind boggling to me. And I don't know if you'd said, Scott, guess, what do you think it is? I don't even know what I would have guessed, but I would have to think it would have been 65 or 70% probably. I mean, if I really sat down, like, I know it's not 90%, but I would have thought it's a heck of a lot higher than it is, and that's really where it all started. I actually wrote a thread based on the strokes gained putting statistics on an online poker forum called 2+2 that was just titled, "Is Drive for Show, Putt for Dough Really True?" And, like, it's funny because it was a bunch of really bad math because we didn't have access to everything yet, but I could just tell something wasn't quite right.
Yeah.
So I kept on thinking about it even more over the next couple of years, and then once they released all the strokes gained statistics in 2013, that's when I was like, oh, I didn't even know that was coming. And now I just know that from shot patterns with like a Foresight quad or TrackMan or whatever that we could, essentially, if I know the standard deviations without getting too mathy of how big your shot pattern is, and I know how many strokes it takes to hole out on average from any given inch and starting condition on the course, then it really is just a very basic. It's funny, like since I've spoken at MIT and Wharton, like I'm so far over my head whenever I go to places like that because I'm like, guys, I did a bunch of really basic weighted average math. It sounds really cool, but like it wasn't anything shocking. And then just to finish the story off, I was going to play in the Texas Amateur. I did this whole little project for my own game. And then in 2014, when it came time for me to Started off, kicking off with the Texas Amateur. I had an elbow injury, so I got a cortisone shot, and the doctor screwed it up. So then I just asked a 17-year-old junior golfer from my home course if I could caddy for him that next week instead. And the, you know, the punchline of the story, for a few years I had to explain who he was, but now it's like, it's Will Zalatoris. Oh, that's pretty convenient that, the 17-year-old kid who's decent at striking a golf ball just happened to be a member at my home course. And then it's even better luck that DeChambeau was going to SMU in Dallas at the exact same time, because he's the second player that I worked, you know, one-on-one with, because the SMU coach told me that his strategy was terrible and he was trying to attack every flag and all the, you know, standard mistakes we all make. So I started working with him in February of 2015, right before he won the U.S. Amateur and NCAAs. And, you know, next thing you know, it's kind of funny because I really do work with, on any given week on the PGA Tour, I've usually worked with between 30 and 40% of the field in some capacity. Whether that's, you know, they had my app in college and I saw they tracked in rounds and watched videos, or, you know, I've done webinars with them or whatever. It's usually about 30 to 40% of the field. And I knew that, and it was kind of intentional by just trying to sell the app to colleges first, because I was like, I realized the first time I went to go work with a player, like at a tour event, it was a veteran, and it was just awful. He was just like, that's not how I do it. That's not how I do it. That's not how I do it. I'm like, I really don't care how you do it, man. I'm here just to explain to you how I'm seeing it, and you can take it or leave it, but you're not going to change my opinion. So it was just, it was brutal. And so I decided I just didn't want to work with those guys, like, for the most part, like that. And I was just going to focus on college kids, shape their brain the way I want to shape it. And then, you know, in a few years, they would graduate out on tour and it would be really simple then. And that's, it's been awesome because it's exactly how it's worked out. So it's been cool. I mean, again, like, you know, what we were talking about just before we started. Now I personally turned 50 on July 4th. I still have mid 170 mile an hour ball speed. So I can hammer it past most of those guys, but Pedraig. And then I'm just trying to get the rest of my game in shape now to really try as hard as I can to make a run at the Champions Tour. It's the hardest tour to get on in all of golf by an absolute mile. You know, but whatever, I gotta do something with my time.
Well, Scott, I am a user of Decade as well. Very new. I'm still, I think I logged like two or three rounds in there, but like, could you just explain?
Cool. Thank you.
Shots gained to or strokes gained to the audience or people. I think just in general, analytics, sure, is obviously making its way into all sports, and now we're seeing a ton in golf. Like, even when you watch on the weekends, right, like all this data, you know, pops up on percent makes and misses and all this stuff. Like, you just generally explain strokes gained so people know kind of what we're talking about. Preface the rest of the combo.
It sounds scarier than it actually is. So rather than thinking, you know, I'm playing a 400-yard par four, we want to start thinking in, I'm playing a scoring average of 3.99 par four. So, again, rather than I two-putted. Is that good or bad? I don't know. Was it a 2-foot putt or a 40-foot putt? So what Mark Brody did from Columbia, once he got access to all the shot link data, he basically went through and was able to figure out that, as a concrete example, on the PGA Tour, an 8-foot putt is 50-50. Meaning it takes you on average 1.5 strokes to hole out from 8 feet. So rather than thinking I've got an 8-footer, think I've got a 1.5 shot. And so if I make it, I've moved the ball 1.5 shots closer to the hole in one shot. So I gained one shot versus my expectation. If I two putted, then I've lost a half a shot to my expectation. And so since we know how many strokes it takes to hole out from every single inch on tour, we could basically start calculating again, was that a good or a bad result? And so then now if we go all the way up to the fairway, from 100 yards in the fairway, tour players average 2.8 shots to hole out. So again, rather than thinking I'm 100 yards, think I'm 2.8. And now if I could hit it to 8 feet, which is 1.5, I've hit it from 2.8, I've hit it to 1.5. So I moved it 1.3 strokes closer to the hole in one stroke. So I, in essence, on that shot, gained 0.3 shots. And this goes to show you how hard putting is. I would have thought that making it, hitting it to 8 feet from 100 yards is a way better shot than making an 8-foot putt. And making the 8-foot putt is almost twice as valuable as hitting it. It's just literally incredible. Like, great, amazing shot you just hit it at 8 feet. And now if you're going to have to hit almost twice as good a shot to actually make this putt. Like, it's just bonkers. And so this is, again, where I get myself in trouble on Twitter and social media. I can't anymore on Twitter. I should just let my account. So
you deleted it. Yeah. I saw that.
Yeah, I woke up on Sunday morning, the Masters. I literally was like, I can't do this again. I cannot do this again. And just, I searched up, how do you delete it? I thought I was going to have one more, like, are you sure? And I did it. And he goes, your account has been deactivated. I was like, oh, shit.
It's not.
Out there literally was going to be one more. Anyways, oh, my God, it's been unbelievable. But, I was like, why did I start that? Like, the last weekend on Twitter for me at Augusta. You know, Colt Nost is on TV talking about on number three, just trying to put it between the bunkers. You know, it's laid up to 100 yards. It's like, dude, it's only 25 yards from the bunkers of the trees. You don't get to place your 250-yard tee shot on the sprinkler head at 100. You still have to hit the first shot. And so then it erupts on Twitter with Andrew Rust. I'm really surprised Andrew jumped in on this because, you're just wrong. Everybody's saying not all 50-yard shots are the same, you know. There's the problem with the analysis. It's like, really? Like, you think that we, especially the Mark Brodies of the world, made that pedantic mistake? Oh, shoot, really? You're telling me that some shots are harder than others? But the separation is not nearly as much as you would think it would be. I mean, it's not even close to what you would think. It would have to be an absolutely absurd shot for a 50-yard shot to be that much harder than any other 50-yard shot, again, on the PGA Tour. So, you know, it's so frustrating. So, because again, they do daily weights, they do daily average, they do take the scoring average of the hole each day. Like, these guys are really smart math dudes, and it just works. So,
yeah,
again, it really is very simple, but man, it's a very powerful tool compared to, like, if somebody said, I hit 57% of the fairways, is that good or bad? Like, I don't know. Do you hit it 200 or you hit it 350? Because that's important in my answer. And so, if there's any one thing I do think that it's hilarious looking back at it, is that we needed actual data to tell us how important it is to hit it far. I mean, like, it's just really comical to me how many people are like, I mean, I already hit it far enough. Like, further is always better. I mean, obviously within certain limitations of finding your golf ball, but man, it's just not even close how important hitting it further is.
Yeah. Tony, here on our thread, Tony, what's your ball speed?
Like a cruiser, like low to mid 180s. You know, if I really press it, I'm like mid 190s or what have you. But
it's just a stupid advantage. Like, it's not fair.
Part of me is like, there are certain holes, depending on what tees you end up playing, where based on your rules, and you put on the overlay from our course, and it does bring a little bit more trouble into play in certain instances. Now, again, that just means that you follow the rules a decade and you hit the appropriate club based on the parameters. But it's a fun deal.
Like, people get like, I'm gonna hit this 2-iron just to get in the fairway. It's like, you might, but you might miss the fairway also.
Yeah.
But there's
yeah.
one thing for sure, that 2-iron is gonna be compared to your driver, and it's about 70 yards further every single time. And it sounds like a joke, but some of the math is honestly also based into, if you've got a tight tree lined hole, at least if you hit driver, you have fewer trees to go through.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I mean, like, that actually factors in sometimes. Like, well, if I miss it, at least I'm past that last group of trees out there.
Yeah.
So, Scott, this kind of leads me to my next question, which is something I've heard you say about decade that I think is really interesting, is that it's super easy to learn and really hard to do. And so could you maybe, like, dig into that a little bit? I'd love to kind of hear, like, thoughts on
did
that.
It last week. That's why I like doing podcasts like this, because I get to talk about all the stupid stuff I do also, because it makes me remember it. And like I said, I don't play much golf anymore. I actually had both my elbows operated in 2021 in preparations for turning 50 and whatever. But so, you know, this is exactly where you would expect this story to start off with. But I got drunk with Charles Barkley on the driving range at Merido here back on July 2nd. And most people, when they meet a celebrity, they're like, they're so funny. And most of them are not funny. But Charles is actually really funny. And so I was still had like a 3-month-old COVID cough. And Barkley's, we're drinking vodka Gatorades. He's got me doubled over laughing, and I'm coughing my butt off, and I tear rib muscles. Point of the story is, I don't even touch a club for 2 months because, like, I could barely drive because the seatbelt, like, for a week or two, like, it hurt bad. So I don't even touch a club for 2 months. I played the Texas Mid-Am on a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and then I played in Corn Ferry Q School starting that Tuesday. And like I say, I bring this up just because I hadn't even touched my clubs in months, and then all of a sudden go out and I shoot 7 under at first stage of Q School, miss by one, and then I don't touch my clubs again for 5 months until, you know, essentially a couple weeks ago, because now I'm going to start trying to get ready for 50. So last week on the Corn Ferry Tour Monday qualifier that's here in Dallas, I'm even par through nine. I had no intention of actually making the tournament. I'm just wanting to play a tournament round, but also need to be like practicing my thinking, not just out there screwing off. On the 10th hole, my ball is about 15 feet away from a tree that is about as wide as a smart water bottle, but I am perfectly stymied. And it was just that I was 75 yards. There's absolutely no rough. Like, I could kick it onto the green from where I was, but I'm trying to hit a little flighty draw around this tree because I'm not disciplined. I want to get a little look at birdie. And I'm like, even though I screwed up, I'm not going to hit the tree. If I screwed up, it's still going to be fine. And I just didn't really think about, A, I don't even have enough club to hit hard enough to actually hook the ball at all. Like, I can't hit this shot hard enough on deadpan from 75 yards and actually turn it. But so then also because I'm trying to like sweep it so much, I just come in so shallow, I just fat it. And I moved it like 30 yards up the fairway. And then I hit a nice pitch shot to like 8 feet, and I hit a good putt and I missed it. And I'm not saying I should have made the easiest par ever, but like, that was going to be a pretty easy shot to just hit somewhere on the green between 20 and 40 feet and two putt it and move on. Again, you don't get to play that. Well, you do get to play the game that, man, you know, I should have shot one shot lower today. Like, I should have shot one shot lower. And that's the whole deal. But Tiger, you know, this is where the Tiger 5 and the Duck 8 app comes from, is Tiger basically just got frustrated and tired of feeling like he should have shot lower every round back in the late 90s. So he came up with these five things. How many double bogeys on par fives, three putts. He tracked bogey with 9-iron or less in order to quantify the data. We turned it into bogey inside of 150. And then he tracked blown easy saves, which obviously we have no idea what that is on tour, so we just turned that into two chips. That's what we helped track for our members. And so I did. I made a bogey there. It wasn't really even one of those Tiger fives, but it was just like, I just shouldn't have been in that position. And so, like, you want to really pick in when I was in my 20s and I finished, I would think I should have shot lower. I never once thought, why do I actually think that? Yeah. Like, I just would laugh about all the dumb stuff we did that day at Outback Steakhouse with my buddies on the Hooters tour. And then would wake up the next morning, do the same shit, be like, you wouldn't believe it. I did it again on six today. Yeah. Like, never crossed my mind. You should try to recognize those situations in advance. And I just always thought, I'm just not as good as I want to be yet. So it wasn't a strategic problem. It was an I'm not good enough yet problem. So the strategy portion never even crossed my mind. And now it's just so blatantly obvious. If you go back to that strokes gain math from the jump, 2.8, 100 yards in the fairway, they averaged 2.8 shots to hole out. 100 yards in the trees, they averaged 3.8 shots to hole out. So if you think about that strokes gain math on tour, assuming they're, you know, actually stymied or whatever, they could chip it out sideways. They'd be moving it from 3.8 to 2.8. They'd be moving it one stroke closer to the hole in one stroke. They could literally almost chip out sideways every time they're in the trees on tour, and it wouldn't cost them that much, if anything. And it's like, once you start realizing these very basic numbers, it's like, what am I trying to do here? Really, I'm trying to chip hook a 7-iron to get a 15-footer for birdie?
Yeah.
I mean,
so brutal. Question about kind of elaborating and some of the information that I found the most interesting when I was diving into Decade is surrounding putting and your thought process surrounding how speed control is king. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, you see all these guys that are, you know, they're aim pointing and everything, and it's like the speed is really king. Just the hole is by nature is going to get in the way. Most of the time, a good amount of time.
Well, and again, the hole is 4.25 inches wide, and I should memorize these numbers, but I was going to try to open it. It's roughly, you lose in the first like 18 inches. So if you hit a putt with 18 inch past speed, you lose roughly half of the cup size due to lip out. So if you hit a putt with perfect speed that got to the lip and just barely sat there, it could fall in sideways with dead perfect speed. If you hit a putt, like it's like 18 inches or 2 feet past the hole, you've taken that 4.25 inches down to either 1.8 inches wide or 2 feet. So when you talk about like all the aim points and everything, if you've got an 8-footer with much more than about, you know, an inch or two of break, which is not much when you're actually reading greens correctly, your speed is going to have more to do with making the hole too small because of hitting a putt too hard. So like your aim point line there, if you technically had dead weight speed, I bet your read could be, I mean, pretty massive. Like, it could be off by a couple inches So like Aimpoint's awesome. I try to use Aimpoint. I'm definitely, as I get older, my eyes suck. And so I'm definitely trying to figure it out because I do believe in it, but I believe in it because I know it's approximately right. And that's all we need on greens, on any putt, you know, 5 to 12 feet is a lot of just overall skill, meaning you got to get a good read. It's a short enough putt, you're probably going to hit it with good speeding. And I'm talking about tour players here, obviously, but if we club players want to get closer to tour players, then that's where we're going to, you know, really hammer it home. And then my start line is just never going to be that awful. I mean, again, you can sit inside on an 8-foot straight putt and just hit the hole every time. But then once you put a little break on it, you're going to start missing the hole a lot because the putt you hit a little harder stays high. The putt you hit a little soft gets low. So even given the identical start lines, the variance in your speed control actually makes your shot pattern bigger. So if you think of like a swarm of bees, and if it all had, like, imagine them growing. I'm trying to think of this. I don't do analogies on the fly very well, but imagine just you had a piece of plywood tilted at about 3 degrees, and you got a swarm of bees and marbles, and you're rolling the all exact same speed. They would just perfectly stay together the entire trip across the plywood. But if you hit them with, like, again, a 12-inch, 20-inch variance in speed, the ones that were hit softer are going to start breaking later. So actually your shot pattern even starts becoming wider just because of your speed. And then that means that if you think about that swarm of bees, it almost doesn't matter how bad your line is. Some part of it is going to intersect with the hole. Like, it really, again, better line, better reads is great, but speed is what everybody sucks at. So even like when I do it, just test with a tour player, I'll just set a ball mark out there at 20 feet and I'll just have them roll 20 putts, just, you know, find a pretty straight, pretty flat 20 footer and just roll up putts at that ball mark and go up there and move them off to the side so you can create like a little shot pattern. And then look at how wide it is versus how deep it is. And it's going to be for sure 3 to 6 times deeper than it is wide. So even if you're worse at golf and your line control's worse, your speed's even worse. So the ratio of roughly 3 to 6 kind of holds true. It's all just a little bit bigger. But even tour players are like that. And so again, once you've got any putt with any break, your speed really actually dictates your line more than your start line.
Oh.
And again, yeah, that's like a concept you've got to wrap your head around. And I know it's weird to use Zalatoris as my poster boy for putting, but I get it. The short putts aren't good. It's not pretty to watch. I get all of that. But he also was positive strokes gained putting on the PGA Tour last year, which is why I lose my mind on the announcers from time to time, if you've noticed. But it was literally one. There's 130 other guys on the PGA Tour last year. They should be talking about their putting over Will. And so it is a little frustrating, but he's the poster boy. But he was also second in approach putt performance, which is the average length of your second putt. The dude has absolutely perfect speed control. And, you know, that is the most important factor in putting. He's, again, I love you, Will, but your putting stroke's not good. And yet you're still a positive strokes game putter on the PGA Tour, and it's because he does it the right way. He does it by focusing on speed.
Yeah.
And everybody can do that. Again, like, once you understand these ideas, again, you know, tying up your question earlier, like, decades really hard, easy to do, but it's really hard to do. This is another one. It's really hard to not try to make putts and just try to lag them close from outside 15 feet. That's the one thing I've been doing over the last 2 weeks. I've been running this. We've got a putting combine in the Decade app that basically we've figured out the average of the 18 starting putts on the PGA Tour. So there's a couple 2-footers. It's like a 57-footer, 24-footer. So it's got these 18 putts and it just shuffles them up, and the expected score is 29 exactly. So if you score 30, you lost one. If you score 28, you gained one. And so for the last 2 weeks, what I've really been trying to do is just really emphasize to myself that if I'm only focusing on speed, I'm barely even reading these things. Like, I'm kind of giving it an eyeball, and that's a 1 or a 2 from aim point. If it's a ridiculous putt, I'll give it a 3. I'm not overthinking it. I'm just hitting a good line, very little attention I read, and focusing on my speed only. And I'm like a +1 and change putter right now, which is, again, it's in like 7 or 8 of these combines. So again, I understand we've got a small sample size here, but it's what I expected. And the theory is working so far. Now, you know, it's going to be harder when you get on faster greens to have that, you know, better speed and everything, but it still doesn't mean that the advice isn't correct.
Yeah. This kind of, this is a good kind of segue into the next question. Cause I think it was Faxon a couple years ago that was saying, he felt like he was putting it best when he hit it 3 feet past. And
I mean, that's where our argument started, right?
Yeah. And basically you just found out that it's not true, right?
I mean, that's what it came from.
And that was just not, like, statistically correct at all, right?
Well, I mean, what happened there, and for the viewers at home, Brad Faxon doesn't like me very much. You'll figure this out by the end of the story. So I'm out there on the course. It was Phoenix in 2020. It was right before the pandemic started. I'm out there walking with a couple tour players, and I'm just checking Twitter, and I see some guy posted. It was Brad and John Graham on a putting green, and John asked him, you know, what do you think about putting or whatever? He goes, how he phrases it, he's like, I know that whenever I was putting my best, it was never just crawling up there to the hole. Like, if I missed the putt, it was going by with enough speed that I was going to have to mark the comeback putt, you know. I just think it's just a bunch of bravado nonsense that he could have easily just been like, yeah, I know, but, you know, get my point. But somebody tagged me for comment, and I just replied with, like, there's no way that's correct. I mean, I'm on the course. I'm with a tour player on six, literally on 16 in Scottsdale. And I'm like, that's ridiculous. No, that's not true. And Faxon immediately fires back at me, goes, so you think you're going to tell me how to putt now? And I'm like, again, in my head, I said, apparently. Well, it's kind of funny when you give it the right inflection. You post it on Twitter and you've got kind of a persona of a know-it-all. It definitely doesn't read well. So whatever, we'll survive. But so then he just starts going on like it's absolutely true, blah, 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 blah. And I'm just like, Brad, I'm on the course, but I'll prove this to you. There's no chance that's right. I'll prove it to you this evening. We'll make every putt. We'll count a mark. You know, you had to mark your comebacker at 2.5 feet. So is Brad Faxon just tapping in a 2.5 footer? I think that's a pretty generous read of the statement. Felt like it was totally fair way to go. So we go run it in 5 foot buckets from 10 to 15 and 16 to 22 or something like that. And then it's like 20 to 32 because we were using 32 feet as we're on tour. They average 2 putts to hole out. So we were trying to keep it inside of like, missed makeable putts. And making up the numbers here roughly, from 10 to 15 feet. Gosh dang it, this is one I got to get right. Hold on, I'm going to get this extra number because I don't want to. It's a shocking number to me. I really, as a guy who I do believe I didn't make it when I was younger because of my putting. So that's what is even funnier about the statement is I played in the 1999 U.S. Open and I was dead last in the field in total putts. Like, and now all of a sudden I'm telling Brad Faxon and I'm going to tell you how to putt. Like, that right there is from the U.S. Open I played. 36 putts each day, pair of 79s, gold. Now I'm telling Brad Faxon. So. From 10 to 16 feet, again, the closer the putt is, I totally agree. Inside 10 feet, you should not be leaving. At the tour level, you shouldn't be leaving many short. But what you've got to do is you got to figure out, I don't want to be hitting any putts more than 3 feet by. So until you stop hitting putts more than 3 feet by, you should continue to leave more and more putts short. So if your shot pattern is 5 feet deep, then you should be leaving 2 feet of your, just think of it a normal distribution curve. You should be leaving 2 feet of it short and 3 feet of it long. So Brad Faxon, he only hit 7% of his, or left 7% of his putts short from 10 to 16 feet. Like, well, that's not much, but he also only hit 16% more than 31 inches long. So he did hit more past the hole than he left short. I'll give him that. But now 16 to 20 feet, and this is not a very long putt. He left 16% short, left 20% 31 or more inches long. 20 to 32 feet, again, 32 feet is where they average 2 putts to hole out. He left 23% short and 25% more than 31 inches long. So it was basically the exact same amount short as to what we would count a mark your comebacker. And then outside 32 feet, where all we're trying to do is 2 putt. Like, that's optimal. He left 43% of his putts short and only 23% went more than 31 inches long. So it's like he is now starting to perfectly center that shot pattern from 50-50-ish. He's at 43%. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's pretty darn close to 50-50. It's just like, that's the data. And the reason I do take this stuff so serious and fight some of the fights I do, it's not for my sanity, that's for damn sure. It's because I don't want a college golfer out there and seeing Brad Faxon say, I jammed him in, man, that's the way you go. Because it's just bullshit. Like, that is all bravado. I just want to sound cool. I didn't fear the comebacker. Cool. Well, you didn't have many comebackers, Brad. That's why you're one of the best putters that's ever walked the planet. I think at some point, the truth matters. Like, I wouldn't have, if you could have just said, wow, that's interesting. This would have been a lot shorter conversation other than then he says, like, I just don't believe the data and that data is wrong. Like, okay, no, that's.
It is the data.
Fair argument.
Math is wrong.
It's one way to go.
It's math.
Shot link, this thing that has been analyzed millions of shots, the PGA Tour is highly calibrated wrong the entire time.
Yeah. So maybe like kind of two questions on this. I would say, like, from an outsider looking in and someone who's followed you for a couple of years, I've just always perceived about you, Scott, that you're just a guy who's extremely passionate about helping people get better at golf. And so I'm kind of I'm kind of curious from your end, like where that passion comes from. Like what, you know, I've always thought of it as, you know, Scott's a guy whose blood boils a little bit when people are spewing bad information, because kids are going to go out and use that information and get worse.
That's it. And it just, the real problem is, it's just frustrating having the same argument day after day after day. And Tim Ferriss has phrased it the best way possible, and I've known this for years, but like, he says, if you're going to argue on the internet, you have to assume your adversary has unlimited time and energy. Because right when you can get that guy to, oh, now I see it, somebody comes along and sees the original tweet and literally posts the exact same thing, and you just pick the football up, you walk it right back to the one-yard line, and you start over. And that was, I mean, again, I said that it was, when I went from like 5,000 to 10,000 followers, that was when I first started really seeing like cynical, just Twitter for what it is. And then once you get to, I think I had right at 40,000 when I just deleted it, then you have so many people seeing everything you post that it's impossible for someone just not to, again, pick the football up and walk it right back and just start over. And it's like, I don't disagree. I don't maybe handle some of it well. I actually typically am laughing. There's a fact that makes my blood boil. He definitely got me once. I mean, he definitely tilts me. There's no doubt about that. But aside from that, I really don't care that much. But it is just frustrating to just know there's no chance I'm not going to sit here and spend another 2 hours saying the exact same thing. And as like I say, I literally woke up, since the final round of the Masters was Easter, I woke up at 5 a.m. to go hide Easter eggs around my house. And then I go back and I was like, don't look at Twitter. Just don't. And I just looked, and there's something there to be like, but you can't call every 50-yard shot a 50-yard shot. And I literally was like, it's 5 a.m. I haven't started yet. I got Europe already on my ass. I can't do this again.
Scott, what do you think?
The deal that's different though. And again, like I get it. I'm not as deft at Instagram for whatever reason, but since it can't be retweeted and the comments, the thing about Twitter is when I post something that is factually correct and it's like influencing my business and somebody posts in there, but you didn't think of this. Like, yes, I did. And we've answered it a million times. But you can't just delete those comments, because I feel like when you do hide reply, that it just brings even more eyeballs to 100%. It. And the problem with Twitter is you have to be so succinct. I can throw a tweet out and the first one can get 100,000 views, like in a multi-tweet, and the second will get 20. And then anything after that gets like 1,000. So you can't make these long, nuanced points because, you know, but on Instagram, at least I can see something stupid and be like, not doing that. Just delete, block and delete too. Like, because I'm like, you're not going to just pop in here and do it again. Just block and delete it. So nice.
So what, last question on this, and then we'll move back to golf. But what do you think people get wrong about you?
You know, that's a good question. I would say that they think I'm a know-it-all, but when I say something's right, it's correct. Like I'll phrase something with this isn't my area of expertise. If we start talking about equipment or swing, somebody, well, Scott, what do you think about this? Like, I always started with, not my area of expertise, here's my 2 cents. I'd waste however many characters that is, just be like, I take this with a grain of salt. But like, once we start talking about math and strategy of golf, like, this isn't, it's not opinion anymore. I mean, that was Colt's thing that he kept on doing on Thursday and Friday, the Masters. Colt's like, well, it's in my opinion. I'm like, it's wrong. Like, can't you have an opinion that's correct? Because it would make life a lot easier. You just, the challenge with what Colt is trying to do there, on number 3 at Augusta, he's saying you should just lay up to 100 yards, which is a 250-yard shot into a 25-yard wide area. I take PGA Tour par 3s. I try to take them when they've got a center-ish pin, and you can start to see how wide shot patterns are. And a shot pattern on a 220-yard par 3 will be 50 yards wide and 50 yards deep almost every single time if there's any wind whatsoever. And I'm not talking like 20 miles, like I'm just saying some wind that the guys are trying to, for whatever reason, fight against, and then the double crosses and everything just start becoming massively amplified. Like, if there's anything at all, the shot pattern is just going to be huge. And so now think about centering that 50-yard wide, 50-yard deep shotgun blast of a shot pattern and center it over the 100. We've got a lot of balls in the bunker. We've got a lot of balls in the trees. And we've got a lot of balls 90 to 130. You're not going to hit it to accidentally hit it to, when you're trying to hit it 200, you're not going to accidentally hit it 220. So the long end, oops, I accidentally scooted it down there to 60 yards. That's not happening. And so we've got this just huge shot pattern. And what was funny is apparently on Thursday, I still haven't gone there. Friday, I haven't even gone back to look at it, but I should because it sounds funny. Colt apparently was patting himself on the back when Tiger and Xander and JT all laid up. And he was just like, three of the best minds of golf right there. His little Texas 23 best minds of golf right there laying up. Woo-hoo. And then Xander made double. And everybody told me it was crickets.
I think you. Like, I just feel like on, you know, Lou Stagner. You know, Lou Stagner. Lou Stagner, the golf stats guy.
Oh, no, he worked for me.
Because he, he had replied to that and said, like, the data on hitting driver on three is like, it's not even close. Like, even take decade method, just
that night,
driver, you make birdie more than you make anything else.
It's not even about making birdie. It's actually about not making bogeys. Like, that's actually what's funny about it is hitting driver, being more aggressive, the reason the scoring average drops is because of fewer bogeys and higher. I mean, yeah. it's just bonkers. Well, Lou, I had another guy that I was using for some data a while back, but he's like a data nerd robot, and I couldn't handle talking to him anymore. And so then Lou popped up, and he only had like 50 followers on Twitter. And I like noticed, I can't remember if he tweeted at me a couple times, but a couple I was like, damn, that's pretty good because I don't know who this guy is. And so I know he doesn't have ShotLink access. He's just scraping this data, but he's like, he's a data scientist for a nuclear power company. Like, he's really good at data. So I just happened to be speaking in Baltimore at the PGA section up there, and Lou's from Philadelphia. I literally took a train from Baltimore to Philly just to meet him to see if I could like him, see if I would like him to then just start having him do data work for me. So like the Brad facts and all those things, like graduated from college in 1996. I understand the mathematical question to ask. I don't understand how to do the data part. Just not what I do. So Lou, going back to what you're talking about there on Friday, I just got a text from him at like 6 o'clock that night, and all it said was, "You're welcome." And I was like, I know exactly what that is. There is no doubt about it. He just destroyed everyone with data from number three.
He's a great follow.
I feel like,
yeah, he's great. I mean, he is really good at using the database. But that's the whole thing. So back to just clarify the one thing where people don't understand that there is ways we can answer questions that some of the announcers don't understand. Again, just because y'all don't know how to answer a question doesn't mean it can't be answered. ShotLink comes in an XYZ coordinate. And the XY would just be like any other normal 2D graph, but then the Z is an elevation coordinate. And so as a made up example, if it's 280 and then 281, you'll know that those two putts next to each other, 381, have gone up one unit of height. And so you literally can know like how the green breaks, how just everything, like to where we're just, again, simply not guessing anymore. And know exactly what make rates are. And then again, like this is what I love pulling this one up over here. Everyone's like, I'd rather have this putt than that hit. So like the slick five foot downhill putt across a 3% slope, like the nastiest 5 footer you could find is a 69% make rate, a 7 foot uphill putt between 0 and 1% grade. So literally a 7 foot inside right putt is 56%. Some people are like, I'd rather have that 7 footer than that 5 footer. The 5 footer is better by almost 13%. Like, and it's just somebody like, well, I'm not very good at speed putting. I'm like, then work on your speed putting. There's no chance you're better from 7. The data's not that different, especially if you guys were saying earlier that you focus on like good kind of club players. If you don't try to chip it to leave yourself a certain putt, every inch from 3 to 8 feet is 1% on your make rate. So if you're like, I'd rather have a 4 footer, I want to try to get that 4 to 6 footer from over there. Like, no, just try to chip it as close as you can because you're just adding literally typically 3 or 4 feet to the average length of your putt in the most important zone from 3 to 8 feet. You're literally just destroying your overall expectation on the shot.
I also kind of to elaborate on PGA Tour coverage is when you're watching PGA Tour events, they only show you the makes or the great, amazing shots. They don't show you the other 80% or 90% of the people that miss the green from 115 yards or, you know, what have you.
And you also just have some guys that are playing good that week. Again, like I don't disagree. People are like, there are days, weeks, you just know you've got it. Like, I don't disagree with that. But by the time, how quickly do you actually know that? To where you're like, now I'm just going to start firing everything on Sunday? Like, you got to have some time to figure that out. And so those guys kind of are, by definition, are playing a little bit better, and they're showing you tape shots and like everything. It's just, yeah, coverage could be a lot better than it is.
Yeah, we agree with that. Scott, what kind of moving to a new subject here, I'm actually really interested on your thoughts on the rollback. Where do you land there on the rollback?
I would be fine with it if we rolled it back on everyone.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be fine with that if I owned a golf course. I mean,
yeah.
I literally, these courses are packed right now. Like, it's insane how much golf is being played. And when I say, like, people would play less, I'm not saying, like, half the people that play golf would quit. But there is some percentage of the people that if you rolled it back 10%, they've been working their ass off for 10 years to get to hit at a certain spot, they'd be mad. And they would play less. I can't imagine how it wouldn't drive rounds down. So I don't think we need to roll it back. I don't think it's the best idea for golf, especially if you're in the golf course ownership side. And then when people talk about bifurcation, I don't think that's the answer. I agree there's something that needs to be done, or if there could be done, but I don't think bifurcation, because over the last 5 years, now maybe it's because a lot of them are players I've worked with, but I've thought it's been fun to see Zalatoris and DeChambeau and Morikawa and Doc Redman and Maverick and Scheffler, like, and just on. The amount of young players that are playing great under the age of 26 right now is unbelievably high. And so going back to even that time when I was out in Phoenix, apparently it's like the last tour event I went to because all my stories are from it, but I'm sitting on the range, I'm watching Kevin Chappell hit balls. Kevin's got a little flat bill hat on, he's wearing a hoodie, he's got on some like mid-calf socks. He looked cool. Like, if I wore it, I would look ridiculous. But he's a good-looking, I would assume early 30s is 30 type guy. But the thing was, is all the kids that were, there was literally 50 kids standing there watching tour players hit balls on the range. And I'm like, they'd rather see him hit balls than me, not just because of my skill, but just because he looks like that. I mean, they could see themselves being on the PGA Tour someday, whereas if it was just me and like my silk Bobby Jones slacks and shirts, like, looking like Elkington out there, like, it's just not going to help do anything but make the game go older. And the reason I think that it would is because you would have to play the NCAA, you'd have to play the juiced ball through the NCAA championship. Like, you would just have to. You can't give up that big of an advantage. So people say, like, they could switch earlier. Like, no, they won't, because there's no way anyone's going to be ranked number one in the world playing a limited ball. And whoever's ranked number one in the world gets all the money to go turn pro and college PGA Tour University. And so, no, they will not play both balls. They won't even practice with both balls. And if they practice with both balls, they're morons, because they're wasting whatever percentage of their time is that they're doing that. They're wasting, in my opinion.
Yeah.
You got college, you got everything else. So I just think the bifurcation, now we graduate from, you know, to turn pro after the NCAA championships, and most of those guys are going to be getting a start in either like the Travelers or the Memorial just right after the NCAAs. There's just not enough time to adjust to that ball that is going to go shorter and handle different and be different on the greens. Just it's by definition, it's a different ball. I just don't think there's any way, especially now with the PGA Tour season wrapping up in like late August, mid August, there's just not enough time for them to come out, get their starts, earn conditional status, or even be like Matthew Wolf, win. Like, that's just not going to happen. And so I think that the PGA Tour would be artificially aged for no reason other than to try to save a couple of historic golf courses that nobody bothers to name. Like, you can ask anybody, name a course that a tour event could go play at if the ball went shorter. And no one will name one, because they did this with me a few years ago when I was getting my Mr. Know-It-All attitude. I'm like, cool, name one. And they named like eight of them. And you don't have to go very far. 17, 18, 16, 17, 18. One of them will not have any room for a grandstand whatsoever.
Yeah.
And this is not Augusta. We need grandstands for major championship golf.
Parking,
infrastructure.
Yeah.
The corporate village and everything. I mean, even Baltusrol has to put the bleachers for number 18 on top of the 18th green of the upper course.
Yeah.
I mean, it just doesn't work. And we're not going to save any courses that actually get reintroduced to the rotation. That's not going to happen.
I'm not a physics expert, but I just feel like stamping a loft on the driver at 10.5 and making the shaft 44 inches, does that not just solve the problem?
But that's going to be optimized for one player.
Yeah.
Why is that fair that he just accidentally gets optimized for?
Yeah.
Making up a name here. But I think Keith Mitchell, I think Keith plays a pretty lofted driver.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's, I think it's 44 and a half. I mean, I think he plays almost what you just described.
And he smashes
and he's
it.
Number one on strokes and driving on tour right here.
Yeah.
And so
yeah.
now you're going to screw everyone else over and let the, like, yeah. you can't standardize the clubs.
Yeah.
Because of it, it will just favor one person accidentally.
Yeah.
It's also why you can't standardize the ball.
Yeah.
I mean, in ping pong or racquetball or tennis or baseball, we're sharing the ball. And that's the thing that's different in golf. It's a no defense, no shared ball sport. So none of the comparisons, oh, the wooden bat, metal bat transition in college. Well, they also get to play defense. They also get contracts. They also get drafted. Like, it's a big difference. I would a hell of a lot rather be number 20 in the world in college baseball than college golf. I mean, you're going to get drafted. You're going to get a chance. I shouldn't say that. I don't have a clue how the farm system works, but I bet you there's a better way to do it than the PGA Tour, which is just impossible. And it's only, I played a practice round with Jordan Eberge last week, and he was explaining to me that I think the Latin tours and Canadian tours are going to combine, which is just like 150 tour affiliated cards are just going to vanish into thin air. I mean, Jesus, like, good luck getting a tour card unless you're doing it off your sponsor's invites. I mean, and so that's why we want those sponsors' invites going to kids that are ready. They don't want them to burn them through the summer and then just be like, okay, that was just kidding. Now you're going to, you played terrible in the seven we got. The guy from the Farmers at San Diego, he's not going to give you one, just cross his fingers. You've had time to practice.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, it's pretty crazy, Scott, just like competition in golf in general. And you're talking about all these young guys coming up and playing so well. And I mean, it's like, Scotty and Rom are kind of at the top of the world right now. And I saw, I think it was actually on your Instagram over the weekend, it was all of, you know, Tiger's records that he has. And I think he said that, like, they will literally never be broken. I was thinking about, you know, like other sports, you know, we just saw LeBron, I think, break the NBA scoring record. Ovechkin's kind of catching up to Gretzky. But, like, why do you think, especially one, in the sport of golf, and two, like, Tiger's records, what makes those a lot different than, you know, maybe some of these other sports where we're starting to see, you know, younger guys come up and really show, like, well, yeah, I can score more goals, I can score more points. Why is golf different?
It's pretty simple, because I do believe, like, where the golf course architect historian crowd that usually doesn't like me, where they get confused is they went and bought a new driver and picked up 30 yards. Like, that's because your old driver sucked, not because the new one is amazing. That's what they don't get. So they see, like, I just gained 30 yards. Bob gained 40. Oh, my God. Tour players come out with a new driver every year. There hasn't been a material gain in ball speeds from a driver in, like, 15 years. And I'm sure the ping guys will light me up for that one not being totally accurate. I've got a 1998 Great Big Bertha Callaway. I have a Strata golf ball, and I've gotten a 1.5 smash factor out of it live on Instagram before. Like, the older, yeah, it was harder to do with it. I get that, but it could be done. And so you're just seeing. So your question is about Tiger. Tiger came out and he hit it so far past everyone and straight as an arrow. Like, it was an advantage that was just mind-boggling. But then where people think that the distance is going to compound to 400 yards, like, I do think that about 195 mile an hour ball speed, I do think that's about the highest that's going to be really usable. Again, after that, the shot pattern just becomes so big. If you hit a knuckleball accidentally at 195 miles an hour, it's off the planet. So at some point you do actually, I mean, I'm the guy that said, hit it as far as you can forever and ever and ever. But even I am recognized, like, there's an upper bound on this. There's a kid, James Hart Dupree, who I've got to work with for a couple of years now. He's 6'9". He took my mini driver and cold put up 205 mile an hour ball speed with a 13 degree mini driver. And it was just like, I'm like, I don't know how to tell a person this big to shut it down. It doesn't even look like he's swinging at it. There's going to be those freaks. But for the most part, you're just, everyone's going to, whereas I don't know what the actual number is of, like, the window of distance, like 165 to 185, and it just has moved up, like, in this 20 mile an hour window. I think that whole thing's going to just scrunch down to about 10 miles an hour, where most people on tour are just going to be in the 180s. Getting over 190 and finding it and playing it is going to be hard for many to do, and keeping it under 180, there's just going to be way too many guys you're giving up a shot to start the run. You can't chip and putt that good. You know, so those 160s guys, I mean, if I got a player that's in the 160s on tour, I'm like, it's all hands on deck time. Like, we need to find some speed here. If I got a guy that's 72 to 75, they're like, I mean, I'm above tour average. I'm like, now.
Yeah.
But I don't want you freaking out, but part of your improvement plan over the next 5 years needs to be 5 miles an hour of more ball speed. So that's not even doing much. But, like, let's be aware of it, because you might just wake up one day and be like, wow, it seems like the tour blew me by. And it's like, yeah, because you've stayed stagnant. So Tiger, A, his distance was such an advantage that that advantage will never exist again for anyone at a playable ball speed on PGA Tour. That's a huge reason why. Second reason, when my cynical, sarcastic answer used to always be, when people would be like, when are we going to have another Tiger? And my answer was, when are we going to have another Vietnam? And as weird as an answer as that sounds, Tita, his mom, is a Buddhist from Thailand. His dad is a black military Green Beret. Those two people are not meeting on bump. Their dads aren't crossing, other than Earl is on a vacation leave or whatever it was. So Tiger's got this incredible parent structure of his mom, who's giving him the Buddhist background, giving him the, I mean, he's literally, when he was the day before his car wreck, he was doing a playing lesson with Jada Pinkett Smith, and she asked him, when did you start meditating? And he just kind of laughed and spurred. He's like, when I was born, you know, with my mom's Buddhism, like, and it's just like, nobody on tour is catching up to that. So that's another shot that you just can't, you know, sure, these guys are out there, they're getting really good at paying attention, but he's got a 30-year leg up on him. I mean, again, or maybe there's some other crazy freak kid who just happened to have the right hippie parents in California that have been, you know, on him since day one. But I just don't think that the parents that he had, which there was good and bad with it. I mean, Earl had his issues and, you know, everything else, but you're just not going to find that kind of upbringing ever again. I think those two things together, just how far he hit it, and that was at least a shot and a half of a year of his dominance. I really believe that too. Well, because we've got data in the Decade app where we track something called the mental scorecard, which is you rate yourself after every shot, you know, pass or fail. Did I know exactly what I was trying to do with it? How far I was trying to carry it, what my directional target was, and what shape I was trying to hit. I don't care if you're confident you're going to do it or not, but did you know what you were trying to do with the shot? And it's amazing how many times in a round of golf, a tour player even says, not really. I'm kind of hitting it that way, but I don't really know. Or if you're not committed to it when you pull the trigger. And so when you track those, that we're trying to get the ratio up over 95% of shots your air quotes committed to. But then with players like that have tracked their stats in the app before, like Maverick and Will, you know, Zalatoris and Doc Redman, some other players that I really trust how they're tracking this mental scorecard part. We take every hole that comes in from them, me, and we compare it what it is relative to par on a negative mental scorecard hole compared to 100% focused on the hole. And it's like a quarter to a third of a shot. So obviously every time you'd like, I wasn't even paying attention there. It doesn't cost you a full shot, but it's obviously not nothing. And so our data, I think that number is about a quarter to a third is pretty accurate, because when college golfers track it, it's 0.58 shots. And I think that's because it's higher, because it's easier to like miss a 5 foot putt and be like, I wasn't really paying attention. And so I think that they rated a little bit high, which is why I say the guys I really trust were rating it. But so now if we're shooting 70, to keep the math simple, and most people at a very high elite level start tracking the stat at about 90%, which that means there's seven shots around that you're kind of self-diagnosing you weren't paying attention to or something. And if out of those seven shots, if we could improve from 90 to 95%, that would be 3.5 more shots around that we're paying attention on at about a quarter to a third of a shot each. Like, that's a shot. And then the math of the driver is very straightforward. Like, I actually think, I mean, that's what I spoke on at MIT last year was the work we've done with the mental scorecard and like quantifying the thought process, because there's really not any other sport where you can rate yourself after every attempt aside from field goal kicking. Like, that's the best one, you know, a similar idea. And so really it's just something that's never even been done before, like trying to quantify the value of paying attention, like quantify the value of pulling your head out of your ass.
Yeah. Hey. Scott, on that subject, so I'm a recovering unhinged absolute lunatic as well. And I kind of wanted your thoughts on the mental game kind of benefits of Decade. I think we've heard Stuart Sink talk about that quite a bit, as well as other guys. kind of wanted to get your thoughts on how you see Decade really helping guys with the mental side.
Well, it's funny because if you'd asked me like 6 years ago, why are all these players playing better? I would have been, it's all the math, it's the strategy. Like, we've just never had anything like that. Now, almost 10 years into it, I'm like, oh no, the answer is me. I'm the problem. I was such a lunatic that most of the content I make is around expectation management and how to apply this stuff correctly. The only reason it works so well is because I was so bad at it. So I just think that the expectation management, you go back to Lou, I mean, that's, you know, there's a number of things I'm pretty lucky about. I'm lucky that I wrote a thread in June of 2011 titled "Is Drive for Show, Putt for Dough Really True?" So I can timestamp it. People have been thinking about this for a long time also. And then Lou, you know, with his hashtag manage your expectations thread on Twitter, I think that's what it is anyways. You know, if in Decade, the second letter E, it's an acronym, D distance, E expectation. Like that's how important it was to me. I gave it the first E. I could have had it last with the last E. I was like, this is the most important part. We have to have proper expectations. Because again, once you realize that 8 foot putt is again 50-50. Again on tour, a 4 foot putt, again, that's where I think it's so frustrating listening to the announcers freak out. 4 foot putt is 88%. Like you miss more than 1 in 10. And a 4 footer is just not that long.
But
and so just really understanding these pieces, again, I'm not saying it doesn't make you want to rip your face off still every once in a while when you do something dumb, but, and this is kind of circling back to work off of something Sam Harris always talks about, though, is just once you understand why you're mad and you're aware you're mad, like the half-life of negative emotions is essentially zero. You can only stay mad if you're thinking about why you're mad. And it's, again, like that sounds like something you should be saying in a California seance of some sort. But like, it's really true. You can only stay mad if you're thinking about why you're mad. And so, again, how Sam Harris says is like the half-life of negative emotions is very short if you let it be. And so, sure, get pissed off. I get it. And a lot of people say, like, you know, I just let myself be mad for 10 seconds and then I stop. I'm like, that's cool if you do it. That's a really hard thing to do if you don't have a system in place, which, again, is why I talk about meditation and everything so much. It's why, you know, Zal Torres, we've been doing this for almost 9 years now. That's why he's able to miss a short putt and not implode. I mean, it pisses him off as much as anyone else. But he's like, well, if I kind of expect it to happen at least every once in a while, can I really get that mad when it does? Like, that's almost the definition of insanity, is like, if you know something's going to happen, like, it can't really make you mad. Or it shouldn't. It shouldn't keep you mad. That's for damn sure.
Yeah. No, that's... It's a solid point. I mean, I guess I had never thought about it that way. And then I, you know, in me just starting to use Decade, I really, like, I'm trying to dedicate this season to just track my stats in general. And picked up Decade because actually one of our guests that we just talked to, he's a aspiring pro. I think he's going to play on the DP World Tour, the feeder tour. He played at Boston College and he was walking me through it all. And that's how I was like, open my eyes. I'm like, oh, I need to go and use this. And obviously I'm not trying to play at that level, but you know, it was like a club player or a you know, called better player in the low handicaps. How can, you know, people of our skill level, whether like ones, twos, maybe even like a plus playing in, you know, local tournaments, whatever it might be, how can they benefit best from Decade and use it? And, you know, I think a lot of people think this stuff might be really far out there and more meant for really elite players, but you know, like, I've watched all the videos and I mean you can apply it, right? So how do people do that and get the most out of it?
Well, it's what we're trying to do is get a tour player's brain inside of a 10 handicap. That can't make a 10 worse. It can only make him better. So we're just trying to shorten that learning curve. Again, it's why I called it Decade. Zalator sent me a text after the Texas Am that he won that just said, you've given me 25 years of experience in 5 days. So like, that's literally where the word Decade came up, just trying to constantly remind us of that. And so, you know, the 0-5-10 handicap, like, and this is where it's weird. Like, there are times when I'm like, people must think I hate playing golf, because like, I do agree that doing it the way I do it maybe isn't quite as fun as like, ooh, I want to really just try to feel this shot and feed it around the trees or like knock yourself out. But you have to ask yourself the honest question. Am I here to shoot my lowest score possible, or am I here to have fun and screw off? I don't care which one it is, but if you're in the first boat which is hopefully what you're in if you're playing in a golf tournament, your club championship, whatever it is. It's just not a magical switch. If I had pulled off that shot from behind the trees the other day, I bet you the next time I had it in something I was actually more interested in doing good in, I would have maybe tried it again. Because it'd have been like, hey, it worked once, but I got kicked in my face. And so it's about learning and being able to even see the problem so that 5 handicap doesn't just go out there and keep on making the same mistake. And again, when you're talking about like how to use the app, I honestly believe that's why I ordered it the way it is. Like, if you're in the elite version, it's the first tab is getting started. The second tab is the mental tab. Because I think that all those videos, it really is the basis to be like teaching Decade is remarkably simple, but the ability to actually implement it with consistency is essentially impossible unless you've put in the work. And that work has to come in your practice rounds, in your casual Thursday afternoon hit and giggle with the wife. Like, you can still hit it and giggle, but you can still make good decisions because you need to be like, man, when I made that good decision, I shot 73. I didn't turn it into a 76 for no reason whatsoever. You have to get that confidence from somewhere. And plus, by definition, that just pushes your scoring average lower. So now if you get yourself in a tournament and you're accidentally a couple under through 14, you don't absolutely freak out because you're like, well, I mean, I shot 2 under a couple weeks ago. I've done this before. I know how to do this. It's just, again, it's just not magic that you get to just say, all right, I'm going to really concentrate now. Like, that's the deal with Tiger. That's the deal with meditation. Been doing it for so long, so long. It's just part of his DNA. And that's Tom Rinaldi asked him on the back porch at Lake Nona after, you know, his first time to speak to the public. And they're like, you know, what happened, Tiger? And he's like, you know, after the car wreck. And he's like, you know, I got away from my core values, my meditation, my Buddhist principles. And it's like, there you go. He stopped practicing, you know. So the 5-10 handicap, you've got to practice this stuff again because you don't want to have to think about it in a tournament. You just want it to be what you do. I have confidence I'm not going to go out there and make a shitty decision.
Yeah,
because I just don't do that. I don't make bad choices.
Well, yeah, once you, I would say for our listeners, like once you understand what Scott teaches, for me, it's really been a process of kind of understanding that I have so much less control over the outcome than I thought I did before. And, you know, we were playing the other day and there was a par 3, like tucked right pin over water, 180 yards, and it's Minnesota in spring, right? It's blowing like 35 straight into us. And I don't even look at the flag, and I just like shove the 6-iron that I kind of filleted, and it rolled to like kick in 3.5 feet. And my playing partners were like, dude, like 6 shot. And I was just kind of like, I actually kind of wiped that. Like, but you know, I picked the right target, and my miss is 3 feet. And
stuff, Eddie.
Yeah, like I think I'm just happier playing golf. Like, standing over a tee, like I know I'm going to hit this thing 70 yards left and right, and whatever comes out is just what comes out. Like, and that is what it is.
I firmly agree with that. Humble Howard, my one buddy from social media that's got his podcast and everything up in Canada, he's like, I stand for lower scores. I'm like, I guess I do too. Like, I never thought I was going to get painted into this corner of, well, that doesn't sound like much fun. Like, really, shooting lower scores isn't fun? I don't even understand that comment. Like, you have to think better. Do you think Nicholas thinks like an idiot and just is that good? No, he thinks better. So I don't get the argument of like, it's not as fun. I'm like, learning to think and play closer to a tour player? Like, I don't, okay, like, keep doing dumb stuff then. Like, I just, are you frustrated every time you play? I mean, again, it's why I try to say, you know, Decade's for you. If you feel like you should have shot lower every time you tee it up, Decade's for you. Like, if that thought makes you mad, I don't care if that's 90 or 70, because even the 90 guy, like, do I actually expect them to get out there and do the whole Decade process and everything? No. But just knowing the information of what drives your scoring is lower, here's the stuff on putting, here's the stuff on expectation. Like, that can't make you worse. And yeah. Again, like, it's the definition of I want to improve. Well, that doesn't mean just physically. Like, you're going to have to do it. I don't think like a guy that shoots 90 and I just happen to hit it good.
Yeah. Like, and even like, even if you don't shoot lower scores, which you will, like we have a saying in recovery, expectations are premeditated resentments, right? Like if you have an expectation, you're just setting yourself up to get pissed off basically. And I would just say for me, the freedom that comes from knowing my shot pattern, the freedom that comes from knowing I really have no control over what comes out other than just the process of making a good swing, just makes the process of playing golf so much more fun.
I actually do agree with that again, because there's times I'm just like, it's mostly people that don't know. They just hear a soundbite. Oh, it's aim at the middle of the green. No, it's not. They see a tweet. Like, there's 20 hours of tutorial content in the app. Like, it's not a tweet. I can't even get people to read three tweets, let alone watch a 90-second video on Instagram, and I expect them to watch 4 hours of introductory content on an app. Like, but I'll tell you this much, Sam Bennett just finished whatever he finished in the Masters. He's hindered 172 rounds in the app since he's been in college. I get more college coaches and college players saying, how can I get my players to enter rounds? Well, I bet you Coach Corton down at A&M has not had to get on Sam's ass 172 times. He'd probably quit at some point. Like, the dude, and I'm not saying he did what he did in the Masters because of that. I'm saying he did what he did in the Masters because he's turning over every stone to be a better player.
Mm-hmm.
That's yeah. it. That's all there is to it. And again, it's not a difficult process. I do. Again, I just stand for lower scores. I just think that it's more fun to be in competition in a tournament and have a chance. I mean,
that's a great.
So point. Scott, where do our listeners find you? I think it's birdiefire.com still.
Yeah, decade.golf. We've all got them to go and direct at the same place now. So just decade.golf. If you search, luckily if you search, I used to say my Twitter and Instagram pops up pretty easily. My Twitter doesn't pop up anymore. Just in the App Store. I mean, again, we've got two versions, Foundations and Elite. It's basically the exact same content. The point of Foundations is, A, it's a little bit cheaper, I made it cheaper because, you know, people are having to take 6 months to get the content. I had to make some sort of a buffer. But the reason I want that is I want, you know, every month you get about 90 minutes of new tutorial content, and it just forces the junior golfer. I mean, again, I'm really focused on junior golfers. I don't want them to beat their head into the wall for 20 years like I did. Like, dude, here's how it works. Take it or leave it. But even if you leave it, you know it. It's in your head. You're going to learn it faster. Even if you dismiss it now, you'll figure it out quicker. So for those, you know, juniors, less experienced players, rather than taking, you know, 15 or 20 minutes to enter the stats from around the golf, you know, again, it just takes time to enter data. It is what it is. Actually, our new interface we just released, I did mine from my Korn Ferry Monday qualifier last week in about 10 minutes, super fast. But they have a much more stripped down stats portal. It starts with just the Tiger 5, and then it adds in strokes gained putting, and then it adds in penalty shots, and then it adds in the mental scorecard, because I'm trying to just get them to build through the 6 months to where then they start tracking stats in the new version. It's just like, oh my God, 15 minutes to enter data, this sucks. So it builds them to that. It forces them to take the content in slower. And then also, rather than using their time to enter in stats, they use the same time to watch content. Again, this is it's interesting. It's hard. I got one PGA Tour caddy that doesn't like me much. And he's always tweeting nonsense like, I can't believe people have to go to a classroom to learn how to play golf now. And it's like, well, your caddy fired you. He bought the app in the app store. He won the next week for the first time in 12 years with his son on the bag. I mean, maybe you should go to a seminar. It's so bizarre to me. But so that's the difference in the two versions. Elite is definitely geared for the more experienced player, but I can't tell you how many people buy Foundations. They get through month one, and then the next day they just try to buy the whole thing, which honestly, another part of it is I just don't want people to binge watch the main first 4 hours of tutorial content. I don't want them to binge watch that because they're not going to retain any of it. So it's another way to just force them to slow down. Okay, now here's for the next 3 weeks. Go think about this stuff and see how it goes, and then come back where you talk a little bit more, and then it just builds over the course of about 4 months.
Awesome. Scott, thank you so much for coming on. Best of luck with your training this summer, getting ready for the Champions Tour qualifier. We'll be following along closely and pulling for you. And if you're in Minnesota, love to have you out to Windsong Farm to play some golf.
I'd love to. I was just out there a couple weeks ago. That's right. We were talking about going to this. I was like,
yeah,
that's, I told you guys, yes.
I'd like to live there.
It's awesome, man.
It's a lot better in the summer. I'll tell you what, you came at a bad time probably.
I can't believe they snowplowed my parking lot in my hotel that night, and there was a 20-foot snowbanker, like a fort. It looked like the Alamo.
Yeah, it's wild. They're still. It was 90 degrees twice last week. There's still snowbanks in parking lots.
That's just,
it's wild. Yeah, but you know, golf courses don't get play 6 months out of the year, so they're money in the summer.
All right. Yeah, I bet they are.
Thank you so much, Scott.
Beautiful.
Thank you so much, Scott. Really appreciate it.
Let me know if, yeah, absolutely. Let me know if you guys have any questions for your own game or anything. Appreciate it. Do whatever you can do.
Thanks again.
We'll do it.
Awesome. Scott. Thank you.
Thank you.